Okay, so the next part is useful tips, you know, and here I'll be giving you quickly, you know, some of the helpful tips for your publication, you know, that cover letters, peer review process, language, and author checklist. So the cover letter is very important. Again, you know, you have to understand that there's a lot of competition for publication space, and for editors, attention is very high. As I said, you know, so many papers are sent to each journal for publication, and there's a lot of competitions, you know, over there. So it is not enough to send a manuscript to a journal editor like this, what you see on your screen, just writing, you know, two or three lines. This is not the way you should send a cover letter. Your cover letter has to be comprehensive. So in your cover letter, you should address to the editor personally, okay? You have to find who is the editor, check his name. If you know the name also, then address personally. Begin by giving your manuscript title and publication type, okay? Give a brief background or a rationale and description of the results, okay? And then explain the importance of your findings and why they would be of, you know, interest to the journal's target audience. So this is, you know, you have to write that in, you know, your in your cover letter, and give your corresponding author details. So as I said in the beginning, the editor decision can be either a complete rejection. He can just simply send your manuscript back to you. He can reject with a major revision. There can be a rejection with a minor revision, and there can be a acceptance without any revision. Okay. Then second is a peer review process, and the peer review process, as I said, only 1.5% of papers are immediately accepted without need for any revisions. And the reasons for the rejections are that if you fail to state a hypothesis, if you are not answering the hypothesis, if you are using some inconsistent terms, you know, in your manuscript, and your conclusion is not supported by your data, because the reviewers will look at your data and they'll see whether it is supported or not, and then your manuscript can be rejected. So what do the reviewers look for? I think I have told you also a number of times during my lecture, but just maybe some more things here. They will look at, is your manuscript sufficiently novel, right? What's the new in your research? This is what they will look first, and these are my favorite questions to all the reviewers which I'm going through, you know, for various journals. Of course, in the good journals, when you see the papers, you know, these things are covered number of times. So is the manuscript of broad enough interest? Is it like for a fight, you know, very narrow, but it's for broad interest? And the novelty, the significance, and the aims and scope and impact factor. They will also look at, you know, the reviewers, whether you can help, you know, your manuscript can help to, you know, increase the impact factor for the journal or not, or whether it is, you know, supporting the aims and scope of the journal. Are the rationale and objectives defined? They will check this. Is enough background given to understand the rationales? Have you justified? You given enough information? Is the literature cited appropriately, whether you had done proper citations or not? Then could a capable researcher can reproduce the experiment? That's what I said in the methodology. If another researcher want to do the same experiment again, can he do that by just reading your manuscript? If he cannot, then your manuscript is rejected. Are results clearly explained and in the best format? Is there any contradictions, you know, within your manuscript? That's what the reviewers will look for in your manuscript. So you have to address all these questions in your manuscript. And when you address, there are very high chances of accepting your manuscript with minor revisions. Have you discussed your limitations, and are your conclusions supported? Now, when there is a revision comes to, generally most of the manuscripts are, you know, ask for revisions. So how to respond to the revisions? So politely respond to all the reviewers' comment in a response letter. Make it easy to see the changes. Refer to line and page numbers. Okay, this is a line, this is a page number which I have made corrections. Use a different color, use different font, highlight the text, okay? And consider additional experiments if suggested. And sometimes you can disagree with the reviewers, but you have to provide the evidence in your rebuttal why you disagree with the reviewers. It is possible you can disagree, but then you have to provide references for that and always comply with the deadlines. Then your language is important, so be consistent. Check the journal's guide, you know, and see, you know, which English you are using. Are you using the British English or US English? Because some words, as you can see on the screen, you know, may be written differently according to the type of English you have chosen. Then minimize your errors. Internet can help you for that. You can use the Google Scholar to check for the word uses. You can check your target journals from the homepage for full instructions. So you can, in MS Word also, when you write, you can track changes, the functions. You can use the comment function. You can use the word count functions, right, to see how many words are they according to the requirements for journals or not. You can use the find and replace to check for consistency. Spelling check, of course, but you have to be very careful. Many times, if you go with the auto spell check, please be careful always with that. And you can always custom dictionaries, right, in your MS Word. Then there is a summary of checklist for the acceptance. You know, first, appropriately designed study. You have to make sure it is done. You have to see that it is a compliance with the ethical guidelines. So there are checklists before you submit, right? So you have to tick mark whether you have, you know, these are met in your manuscript or not. Novel and interesting results, correct statistical techniques, clear, concise, and accurate writing, significance of findings explained, appropriate choice of journal, and you have compliant, you know, with the guide for authors. And then, you know, you have to send your manuscript. So then again, for the abstract, as I said, you know, you can go with a structured abstract. Why? Because, you know, when you write a structured abstract, it is easy for the authors to write. It is easy for readers to understand. And also, you know, it is good for computerized indexing, you know, you go with the structured abstract. So in a structured abstract, according to IMRAD format, it is like introduction, method, results, and discussion. This is how you write a structured abstract. Then there are certain useful sets of phrases, you know, in abstract, what you can do, like you can write, here we present, here we show, here we report, and in this work we introduce. This is how, there are some of the important, you know, phrases that can be used, you know, in your abstract. And in introduction, there are certain important phrases are like, we demonstrated previously, previous studies have shown that, or therefore we tested the hypothesis, and this report describes the experiments. In this study, we sought to extend. So these are some of the useful phrases. I think I don't have to read each and every one. You can just see it later on, you know, when this is made, you know, accessible to you, these slides. Then these are certain set useful phrases for the methods where you write, like, to test whether we performed, to examine, among the cases we analyzed. So these are some of the phrases which you can use. In discussion, you can use the word phrases like, in the current study, we have shown that, in summary, to conclude, in conclusion, in demonstrating our findings, show that, illustrate, you know, and like that, you can have some of the phrases. And these are some of the phrases, you know, for your cover letter. And always make sure that the authors have no conflicts of interest, you know, to declare or briefly give information describing any conflicts, okay? So this also, you can read it later on, you know, the useful phrases, you know, for your cover letter writing. For statistics, as I said before, also always consult an expert. State the statistical test used to analyze the data very clearly. And also, it is important to provide the name and version of the statistical package. And you have seen that many times this has been provided, that I am using, for example, if you're using SPSS 24 version, so you have to write very clearly that we have this SPSS 26 version has been used, you know, in this study. And only use the word significant when describing statistically significant differences. Never use word significant if your results are not significant statistically. You can use the word like, we have seen the improvement, we have seen the marked improvement, but the results are not statistically significant, okay? Or like, as I said, you know, if your results are not significant, you know, then you can use the word notable, substantial, marked, you know? So these are the alternatives if your results are not statistically significant, okay? Then another important thing which are like some additional things which is important for research, for the researcher, is like how to check their plagiarism. So there are softwares, you know, which are easily available, like iAuthenticate. I use personally iAuthenticate, you know, and many times maybe you have to take these subscriptions for this, you know, and your institutions, your universities, they also provide you access to these software, so they can check the plagiarism, authenticate, or Turnitin. You know, they are Turnitin is good for the students normally, but for other professionals, iAuthenticate is good. There are many other also, many journals they use, the others, you know. So I'm just giving you a few. To check your references, whether your references in which style you have to write, you can use a Google Scholar. Just type, you know, and search, you know, the topic or you know the title and the author in the Google Scholar, and then you can cite from there, you know, and you will get, you know, how to, like, you can get different, like you have to cite according to Vancouver style or, you know, AMA style. Different styles are offered and you can choose accordingly. Then as a researcher, one more thing very important is, you know, the important IDs. All the researchers, if you're doing a research, and generally, you know, it's in all the faculty members, if you are in working in higher education in any university or institute, you must have an ORCID ID. And this is now made almost mandatory, you know, even if you apply for some job anywhere, you know, as a faculty member for the position for associate or professor, they will ask you this information in your resume. What is your ORCID ID? What's your researcher ID? Do you have the Pablon ID? Pablon is basically for the Web of Science, right? And the research gate. So these are, you know, and also, you know, you have to write your Scopus ID also. But once you have the ORCID ID and you have already created the Scopus, the ORCID can, you know, can show, you know, you other researcher IDs, because these IDs are now linked to each other, the ORCID ID, Scopus ID, the researcher ID, they are all, you know, are linked to each other. So these IDs are very important. So if you have made any publication, you know, you can just simply, you know, access, you know, the you know, the publications, you know, the of a particular person, you know, through these IDs. Like I have shown here at the bottom, you know, the researcher ID, how it is, the Scopus author ID, you know, at the bottom of the screen, and the ORCID ID. Okay, so one more thing very important before you go for any publication, and this is most of the universities, they comply to these, you know, things, that's, there are so many predatory and hijacked journals available nowadays, because everything is, most of the things are online. So there are many, you know, predatory and hijacked journals. So you should not try to publish in a journal which are not recognized, you know, by your university or the institution or the authorities. So what actually they are, you know, is that the predatory publishing is basically, it is defined as for-profit open access journal publication. So many times you just give, you know, the publication charges, and the journals, they just publish your paper. They don't go for any review, you know, not any robust review, and they will give you the acceptance in a very short period of time. So they just want, you know, the money. So you just pay to them and they will publish your research. So that publication is of no utility or value. So these are called as a predatory, you know, publications. So Committee on Publication Ethics, that is a COP, which is a nonprofit organization committed to ensure high standard in publication ethics. Basically, in the hijacked journals, also known as a journal phishing. So the phishing also happens, you know, in the journals and publications. So you should be aware of. So if you are trying to publish in a very reputed journals, you have to see, you know, there are duplicates for that journals also. So there are fake websites which are created to mimic and authenticate, you know, for the reputable journals or their websites, and abusing their names and identities, even like ISSN numbers also. And typically the hijacked journals will call for paper submissions which claims to be indexed by reputable entities such as Thomson Reuters, Scopus, or PubMed. So any reputable journal, they will not send you an email that please send a manuscript to us and our journal is, you know, published, you know, indexed in Web of Science, Scopus, or PubMed. So these are called as a hijacked journal. So you should not, you know, publish, you know, in those journals. On the bottom of your screen, let me just highlight it, you know, I have shown here a website, you know, web address, you know, for the predatory journals. If you just click on this, you can like, you know, copy this in your browser, and you can see the list of the journals where you should not publish. So make sure that when you are writing, submitting any journal, a manuscript to a journal, check whether your journal is in this list. Because if it is in this list, then your university or institution may not be going to accept that publication. So publishing in a predatory, open access, and high-tech journals will negatively impact the integrity of academic publishing. So try to avoid, you know, these types of journals. Now, sir, something about the Web of Science journals. As you know, in India also now, for last maybe 1 year or 2 years, the UGC has made like it mandatory to publish, you know, in the Web of Science journals, or, you know, in, you know, the UGC care, they have a UGC care list, right? So first, let us understand what is a Web of Science, if some of you are not aware of it. So earlier it is called as a ISI, it was called as ISI journals, then the Thomson Reuters, they own that, you know, but now this has been owned by Clarivate Analytics. So this is the name on your screen, you can see Clarivate Analytics. So this is previously known as Thomson Reuters, okay? And it is, you know, popularly known called as a Web of Science, okay? And in the Web of Science, actually there are, only four in, there's so many indexes, you know, in Clarivate Analytics. In, we can say there are maybe more than 20 indexes probably, but the only four index are included in the Web of Science, which we called as a Web of Science core, you know, core collection. So the first is Arts and Humanities Citation Index, then Science Citation Index, expanded, Social Science Citation Index, and then Emerging Source Citation Index. So what does it mean? It means that if a journal which is indexed in any of these four indexes is called as a Web of Science journal. So if you want to say that your journal has an ISI, is your publication is ISI or a Web of Science, then it has to be indexed in these four, you know, indices. And how do you know that the journal you're looking for is in Web of Science? Many times, as I said, these hijacked journals or predatory journals, they claim that, you know, they are indexed, you know, in Web of Science. And they will write the index. Then you have to, any journal, if you are indexed in ISI, they will write in which index, you know, they are, and they are included. So then you should go to this web address on your screen, this, you know, clarivate.com. So there is a master list for all the journals here. As I said, there are around 24 index, you know, in this master list, but only four index are in the Web of Core, Web of Science core collection. So when you click on this, clarivate.com, then you can just type the, you know, the journal name in the search area, and then you will see the journal. If the journal is in Web of Science, it will appear there, and then you will see at the bottom of the search in which index that journal is included, whether it's Emerging Source or Social Science or Science Citations or Arts and Humanities. So this is how you can find out whether your journal, you know, is in a Web of Science or not. Okay. Now, the another important is to know the citation reports, that is called a journal citation reports, which is a JCR service. This is again provided by the clarivate.com, and the website, you know, you can see here, this is a website, visit, you know, this website to see, you know, the journal citation reports. So what is the journal citation reports? Now, it offers various quality metrics about the journals listed in Web of Science, including most importantly, the ranking quartiles. Like as I told you in the beginning, if your journal is Q1 rank, Q2 rank, Q3, and there are four ranks, Q1, Q2, Q3, and Q4. Now, if your journal is ranked, how will you know that? You can only know when you access this journal citation reports. And for this, you need to have access to this, you know, this web page. And I don't know whether, you know, generally we are not when you register for Web of Science, you don't have access. That this access is usually through the university and institutions. Like I can access to this if I can access it through my IP address from university, and I can access. I'll show you in next coming slides, you know, how important this is actually, you know. So it, as I said, it offers various, you know, your Q ranks for the journals, and then you can get various metrics, you know, the history of the journals, you know, and like ranking in the last 10 years, or, you know, 5 years or so and so. I'll come to that little later. So first, let us see the Web of Science core group. As I said, there are four indices in that, you know, arts and humanities, emerging source citation index, science citation index, and you can see the numbers of journals in those. So there are large number of journals, you know, in these, you can say. So there are total 235 subject categories, which can be found, you know, in Web of Science, 235 subject categories, you know, and then, you know, almost 22,395 journals. This is a data for like 1 year back. Maybe this data has, maybe it is increased or decreased. I cannot say right now. So then the UGC CARE list, if you look at the UGC CARE list, group one, they have group one and group two. In group one, they have like four areas: science, arts and humanities, multidisciplinary and social science. So UGC CARE, this is as per the last year data, they have 1,141 journals. So if your journal falls in this list, then you can publish and it will be recognized, you know, by your university. Then UGC CARE list group two. In a group two, they have, you know, this Web of Science, and they have these three indexes included by UGC: Arts and Humanities, Science Citation, Social Science Citation Index, and Scopus scores list. So Scopus is also included, you know, by UGC, you know, in a group two. So if you publish in a Scopus journal, it will be, you know, maybe your publication will be counted, you know, for your promotions and whatever purpose it is. Now, these are like the data which I am showing to here. Now, these are like top 20 journals by the subject categories, you know, like in subject categories. This is not by the journal, this is by the subject category. So if we, this is a data for 2020. So in 2020, you know, the economics, you know, subject, you know, area, it is ranked number one according to the Web of Science. So this data is from the Web of Science journals, right? And this data I have access because I have the access to the citation reports. So this data you can only get if you have the access to the journal citation reports, right? So if you see the economics, they rank, you know, number one, and they have around 363 journals. Mathematics is ranked number two, and this is have 314 journals. Then biochemistry, followed by material science, neurosciences, pharmacology, and so on. So you can see here, this I, because of the space limitation and time, I was just able to show you the top 20, you know, categories by subject. As if you recall, I have said there are 235 subject categories in Web of Science. So from the 235 subject categories, you know, this is economics stands at the top as per, you know, the last year data. This is not the latest, of course. Then if you look at by the top 20 journals, you know, which is the top ranked journals, you know, journals category by the impact factor. And if you look at the nanoscience, you know, and nanotechnology has 94. This is by the impact factor, on the basis of impact factor, which is the top 20. So nanoscience now here comes at the top because of the impact factor. So they have the aggregate impact factor is 6.79. Then cell biology, you know, has 5.9. And chemistry, multidisciplinary. So again, this is by the subject area, not by the journals. Okay, so and you can see number of journals, you know, in these categories, right? So this is again the top 20, again from the 235 subject areas in Web of Science, the top 20 by the, you know, impact factor. Now these are the journals, which are the top 20 journals. Again, this is for the previous year. And the top 20 journals, you know, according to the Web of Science, that is Clarivate Analytics. The first is, you know, the journal for the cancer journal for clinicians. And it has, you know, the impact factor. You can see the impact factor is so high, 223.679. That's very high impact factor, you know, and total number of sites, 32,000, you know, but impact factor, you know, again, depends upon, you know, the number of papers it has, right? Then the Nature, we all know about the Nature, the journal, it is the Nature Review Materials is ranked number two. Then New England Journal for Medicine, the Lancet, you know, I think most of you have heard about Lancet during this coronavirus because many of this, you know, data for this, you know, vaccines, you know, have been published, you know, in the Lancet, some of which, I think even if I'm not wrong, I don't know, Covaxin or which one is published in the Lancet. So Lancet is ranked number four. And so on, you can see, you know, the list of, you know, these top 20 journals by the, you know. So with regard to the sports sciences, I am from physical education sports background, you know, the sports science, you know, it rank at 124 by the subject category. So there are 235 subjects, and the sports science, if there is any teacher here from the background from the sports and fiction just for their information, for others also normal. So we have the rank for the sports science is 124, and there are, you know, there are 124 journals basically. So in the science, there are 78, you know, in science citation, 15 in social science, emerging source 31. So there are 124 journals, you know, in the Web of Science core group. And if you look at the rank now, that wasn't the rank, that was the number. And the rank for the sports and category is 91, which is, you know, quite high looking at in the other subjects. So from 235, you know, subjects, the sports science ranked at 91, and there are total like 415942 sites, and the average impact factors for the sports science is 2.738. And to conclude, you know, with my last, you know, slide probably, and this is the top 20 journals in the sports science. And this is since I have given, you know, for all the related fields. So this is for the sports science. We have British Journal for Sports Medicine ranked number one. Then we have Exercise Immunology ranked number two. So when we say one and two, this is our Q ranks: Q1, Q2, Q3. So like this. So therefore, the ranks are divided in four quarters. Okay. So the first, the top first quarter is called as a Q1 rank, then second is Q2 rank, third is Q4, and the last quarter is Q4 rank. So this is the ranking for the sports science journals. Now, these are some of the, like, from the journals in economics. If there are some here, you know, the participants from the economic field, so you have the quarterly, and again, this data might have changed this year. So and this is an old data for previous year. Quarterly journal for economics, rank number one. Economic geography is ranked number two, and like this, you can see the data for the economics. A top 10 journal. So like this data I'm just giving to you so that if you are trying to publish any paper, why not target, you know, these top journals for your publication? It's always, you know, very, like, you know, it will have a lot of impact on your research if you are able to publish in the top 10 journals. Okay. And then these are the top 10 journals in biology. So physics of life reviews, the biological reviews, PLOS biology, you know, eLife, BMC biology, so and so on. Then top 10 journals in engineering. So those who are from engineering field, and you can see these are the journals, you know, which were ranked top in the previous year. And you can, you know, aim to publish in some of these journals if you are interested. And then top 10 journals in management. Of course, I just try to, you know, include some of the fields. There, as I said, there are 235 categories. I cannot show here all the categories, but I just try to show some of, you know, the, like, a few subjects which I feel, you know, maybe I could, there will be more participants from these areas. So these are top 10 journals in management. Then, you know, top 10 journals in mathematics. And mathematics is quite common, and there are many, you know, maybe, you know, faculties from mathematics. So here are the journals for mathematics. You can choose any of these to publish your research. These are Q1, of course, generally Q up to top 10, they are Q1 journals, and Q1 rank is very high and very reputable rank. Then top 10 journals in psychology. So there's an annual review of psychology, which is ranked number one, psychological bulletin, annual reviews of clinical psychology, and so on. And then top 10 journals in sociology. So annals of tourism research, American Sociological Review, annual review of sociology, you know, these were last year's rank. And then this is again for the sports science, you know, I'm just showing, you know, how the sports science have, you know, evolved and developed in last maybe 20 years. Yeah, initially they have only 81 journals, and now, you know, sorry, 71. This is up to 2017. I don't have a data on that. And, you know, there is a lot of, like, you know, improvement in the sports science, especially, you know, in the research in last 20 years. This is the data from all over the world, what I'm showing to you. And that's it. Thank you so much for giving me this time and opportunity. I have concluded my talk here, and if any one of you have any questions, you want further more information, you can access my email through the organizers, and you can request them. I just, you know, give my consent to the organizers to pass on my email to all the participants. You can ask me any questions through email. If anything is not clear to you, you have further communication, you want any clarification, so I'll be most happy to answer your email, you know, within I'll reply, you know, with as soon as possible, whenever I get time to do that. So with this, I think I am concluding within 90 minutes has been allotted to me, and this is just a couple of seconds left. So thank you so much, the entire organizing team, for making this event, you know, like possible, and for the benefit of the participants. And I thank you for giving me this wonderful opportunity to give my lecture on the topic on scientific in higher education. I particularly thank, you know, the entire organizing team and the professor, you know, Lata, and Dr. Shikha Chaudhary, you know, from physics education, who has taken this initiative and given me this, you know, well, facilitate, you know, my lecture for this program. Thank you, Dr. Shikha. Thank you so much, and wishing you a good luck. Namaskar.